Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Here is that I guess all of us will make few pertinent comments that we think should be made. Robert has certainly brought up many issues with which I agree completely. One of the things that we asked earlier in the conference is for everybody to contribute a scenario that will somehow connect computational science education with research needs. And some people did. But basically, they all boil down. Students need to learn the skills to do the following. And then comes some description of some research to be done. And so that's useful. We can kind of go through this and see, you know, what are the most commonly desired skills. Let me make a couple general comments about this. Like some of you, probably I encountered some resistance in trying to start a new kind of curriculum in computational science skills. And I won't bore you with stories, but basically we do have a class called Methods of Computational Science at Caltech Astronomy, which was actually shared with biology, and students from different fields were coming to it. The problem with all this is that we don't teach these necessary skills for 21st century to students because professors don't know them. And the way I solved that is I had people who know them teach them, like scientists in my group. Ashish Mahabal, Matthew Graham, Chiro Donalek, other people at Caltech, people from outside of Caltech. For example, we had David Heckerman come and give a talk about Bayesian nets, and he's the world's greatest authority on Bayesian nets. So it's possible to do this if you step out just slightly outside of the normal box that professor is responsible for delivery of the information. I was more like a ringmaster. The second thing that I'd like to comment on is that many of us seem to be reinventing the same kind of curriculum. I think it will be a really good idea if we're to come up with an effective sharing mechanism for bits and pieces and modules or anything that we can reuse and recycle between different universities and so on. And finally, I think since the mode of learning has changed and it continues to change, students are getting all of their information online, that we need to recast the way we compose teaching from traditional textbook and lecture format to something that's optimized for individual customized use purely online. And that we need to design curricula and materials that students can access on their own and combine in whatever ways they actually need, as opposed to one-size-fits-all approach of traditional lectures. And that's exactly what internet enables us to do. So with those comments, I'll just shut up.
Here, wrap up the stand.
So we put the names alphabetically, but we don't have to go that order. Let's just go around the table, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the brief comments I wanted to make are pretty much along the same lines of the argument.
Just before you make your comments.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, how about a name?
Is there any chance just to say who you are? Because we've got a whole
sure,
lot of people
sorry.
Right behind you.
Yeah, that's true. It's awkward.
And some of these guys, I guess, are graduate students.
Yeah.
Right.
And some are a bit more than graduate students, but mainly they're graduate students, and I guess they're sort of at some level the target audience. And they're also quite multinational. So there's a little bit of an American angle to this, but I think the distance learning ideas that George brought up there are relevant when you go sort of pan-European, Chinese, etc.
You want to just go around and introduce and then do the lectures?
Introduce
yourself. But the name would be very nice.
Yes.
Okay. Start from me. I'm Yan Xu. I'm your local host at Microsoft Research. I'm so happy that we can have you here, and then I'm sure that we will continue work together for the next few days, taking this with school from Microsoft Research to University of Washington for the next a few days. So here today, this is the day 4 of Astroinformatics workshop. Like I mentioned in the beginning, we're focusing on connecting research with education. I'm glad that you can be here joining us. With your input, I'm sure that we can come up with at least we want to improve how we can bring research theories into the classroom.
And I'm George Drogowski from Caltech. I'm nominally an astronomer, but I've been spending more and more of my time on e-science matters, and including the issues, how is information technology going to revolutionize completely education? And one of my pet peeves is that academia operates on a 1,000-year-old business model, and that just has to change in the 21st century.
My name is Jim Crutchfield. I'm in the physics department down at UC Davis. I run the Complexity Sciences Center there. I guess nominally my background is in theoretical physics, but my physics colleagues think I'm a mathematician. But I'm very interested in teaching computational science, but through looking at particular kinds of complex, chaotic, fractal-type systems. They're nice, very simple to specify systems that generate completely non-trivial data, and that sort of nicely trip you up when you try to do standard statistical analyses. So that's a nice sort of focus. And I'll mention a little bit more about that to Grant just in a second.
My name's Andy Connolly. I'm from the University of Washington. I work on the LSST. My interests are on large-scale machine learning applications to astronomical data sets. I'm also interested in visualization, and in particular moving visualization into the browser. So trying to use the technologies that industry uses rather than something that astronomy tends to do, which is to try and reinvent everything from the ground up without looking at what is available out there. And I am the UW host for the summer school that Nick has been arranging. So if you have any questions on the logistics, I'm the person to talk to.
Shall I say who I am then? So I'm Nick Walton. I'm at the University of Cambridge Institute of Astronomy. I'm a member of the ESA Gaia science team with a focus on some of the data aspects of Gaia. I've also been involved in the virtual observatory world in terms of information technology. I was involved at some level of that effort that Andy was referring to, which was let's ignore the industry and create everything from ourselves in astronomy, because that's a fun thing to do when someone pays you to do it. And I think Andy was right, so we encourage those sort of developments.
Yeah.
So I've also involved in training and graduate training. So trying to interface some of these elements together is a sort of my interest, I guess. So in terms of the people in this room, so the people around the table, some of the students here are from a training network, which is a pan-European activity, bringing together research groups in Europe, which are who are involved in the exploitation of Gaia. Gaia is an astrometric mission coming up from European Space Agency, launching end of next year. These basically are students associated with research groups in those institutes. So there's 13 main institutes across Europe, and they're all got some sort of PhD project which is involved in aspects of mainly galactic astronomy, from structure of the Milky Way down to looking at solar system aspects and so forth. All of those science projects require some sort of handling of data and visualizing data to exploit the data and so forth. And that is the purpose of this training school that we've jointly organized with Andy Connolly and his colleagues over in Washington and the LSST. So it's a fairly sort of a small event, if you like, at some level, but it brings together people from across a number of disciplines and groups. So that's the sort of background why these people are in the room, and we're going to be moving on over the next few days to look at some hands-on use of some of the technologies and techniques, if you like, that we have to visualize data around the Gaia mission. So we'll be looking at simulation data and ground-based data that goes with that, and trying to
look at some of the visualization techniques. Mark Taylor, that was referred to there, for instance, will be one of the lecturers showing how things like SAMP can be used to integrate various tools and so forth. And then we'll also be looking at some LSST-related topics, a special focus on handling the technical data, for instance. So that's the background as why we're here interacting on this handover day, so to speak, with the Astroinformatics conference that George and colleagues have organised. So, sorry. Next up.
Okay, I'm Kirk Bourne, sometimes called Captain Kirk. I'm at George Mason University, which is in Northern Virginia, just outside of Washington, D.C. I am an astronomer, after 20 years working on various NASA projects, I moved to the university about 10 years ago into the Department of Computational and Data Sciences, which was not where the astronomers were located at my university, which was a very interesting scenario. So just last year, we merged with the Physics and Astronomy Department, so for the first time in 30 years, I actually am an astronomer in an astronomy department. The focus of my research in the first half of my career was on galaxy research, colliding merging galaxies, and about a dozen years ago, I moved to what we now call data science, but for me, the main focus was the study of data mining, application of data mining to just about any large data set. And so now if people really push me hard, I'll tell them that I'm a transdisciplinary data scientist. I learned this word over the summer, that transdisciplinary means it transcends disciplines. And so now I work with and talk with people in the business school, the engineering school, the health school, the school of education, because everyone's dealing with large quantities of information and data and need to solve problems. And so I'm here saying some of the same things that Robert Brunner was saying in his talk, that is what we teach to our astronomy students, that those techniques and ideas transcend our science and really should reach out to all disciplines. And that's what I'm here to talk about.
Hi, I am Giuseppe Longo, I'm Italian. I am, in theory, I'm a professor of astrophysics at the University of Naples and a member of the National Institute of Astrophysics in Italy. In practice, since 12 years, I have not the faintest idea of what I am. I'm so glad that you know very well how to define yourself. But I don't know. I'm no longer an astronomer. I'm not a computer scientist. I think I am a sort of progenitor of this astroinformatics group of people. I coordinate a group of data miners who have their main interest in the application of data mining and machine learning techniques to massive astronomical data sets. And we try to maintain the double identity. On the one hand, we develop infrastructures for astronomical data mining, and on the other hand, we try to make application to real astronomical cases in order to show that these things really work. And on the specific topics on which we are discussing today, I have a long-lasting, several years, collaboration with George at the California Institute of Technology. Therefore, there will be a lot of overlap between the things which we say, but that is for granted.
Who else?
Yeah, my name is Chen Zhou Sui. I came...
Is it
around? My name is Chen Zhou Sui. I came from National Astronomical Observatory of China. I'm leading the Chinese Virtual Observatory efforts in China. And my work is mainly to provide data access services to astronomers in China and around the world for our data sites and develop some practical software tools for our users. And we have strong interests in education for the informatics and data science, scientific data-based education. So during the last several years, with my colleagues in China, we take the worldwide telescope into class, and we also organized several teachers' trainings to teach teachers how to use the worldwide telescope to teach students for their classes, for their colloquiums, and so that they can use the worldwide telescope and the virtual observatory tools in their class. And their students know data science and astroinformatics. Yeah, thank you.
Ashish.
My name is Ashish Mahabal. I'm an astronomer at Caltech. And as George mentioned, I've been involved in teaching of astroinformatics there. Besides that, as my slide here will show, I'm interested in crowdsourcing. And I'm also involved in the USVO. The team meeting is happening in the next room, so my time will be split between here and there. And as far as LSST and Gaia goes, I'm also involved in LSST transients and Gaia transients related activities.
Nikos?
Jeff, it's your turn.
You'll go, Jeff.
Okay.
Turn that off, yeah.
Okay, so my name is Jeff Dozier. I'm a professor at the University of California, Santa Barbara. I'm not an astronomer. I'm actually trained in physical geography, and as a dean about 15 years ago, I started a School of Environmental Science and Management at Santa Barbara. And I was dean for 6 years. I was able to raise a lot of money, and then I promoted myself back to the faculty because I thought they were having more fun. My integration with the astronomers partly comes for two reasons. One is that a lot of what I do in the environmental sciences is I use remote sensing. And so we have the two common problems. One is to try to interpret properties based on what we can see in some sort of an electromagnetic signal. And secondly, we have the same problems of handling data that are big, bad, and ugly. And what I mean by that is not only the volumes of the data are problematic, but also the structure and the organization are also that way. In my own work, I mainly study snow hydrology. I'm a certified ski instructor, so I have another career to fall back on if I get fired from the university. So thanks.
For the students, let me just tell you about a couple of things. There's a Facebook page just called /astroinformatics, where you're all more than welcome to enter your comments, questions, tell us what you need. It's an open discussion forum. There is also a wiki, astropub.pbworks.com, that Ray Norris has started yesterday as a result of a very vigorous discussion of how do we reinvent scientific publishing in most general sense in the 21st century. Again, everybody is welcome to contribute constructively to that. And actually, the conference itself is called, the website is astroinformatics2012.org, and there is 2011, and there is 2010. And in each of those, there are slides from all the talks, and there are videos of all the talks, webcasts, in the case of the first conference. And you might find this useful.
Yeah, who's next?
You.
Me? Well, I figured out, so I want to share my problem with when I was, building up the agenda for this conference. I wanted to recruit some of the best researchers and Microsoft research to join this conference. And George asked, for example, we want some data mining researchers to come to speak. And then when I talked to those people and they said, do we mean the same when we talk about data mining from computer science and then from astronomers? So my question really is, when you talk about data mining, what do you mean by that? What are you mining? Is it data, tables of data, numbers, or is it text, or is it images, and streaming of images? And your goal is to discover the pattern in data or in images, and what your goal is to discover an algorithm that can be reused in the field.
So that's the question that I received from, you know, when I ask our data mining researchers to come to speak to astronomers. They were not sure. So I throw this question to you, and then I'm hoping that by discussing other scenarios you brought up, maybe I can come up with a better understanding. When you say, I wanted to talk to a researcher on data mining from Microsoft Research and what exactly you are looking for. So that's mine. Shall we go to the next?
I was saying. So most of you weren't here on Tuesday. So my talk on Tuesday was sort of looking at the sort of history, and I was trying to flatter my astrophysics colleagues by noting that celestial mechanics and astronomy have had a key role in enriching our notions of how chaotic and complicated and structured the world can be. This has turned into this abstract field of dynamical systems theory, and so that's sort of my background, to understand what's the origin of randomness and pattern and structure in the world. So, and the point I was making at Tuesday was that those sort of first principle mathematical phenomena actually lead to the need for a type of informatics type approach. In particular, I was emphasizing visualization and talked about, kind of ended the talk on something I think everyone understood, which are kind of gadgets, the new world of immersive visualization and how it's coming to a laptop near you soon. But the same point, I think, applies for education, the same complicated phenomena. So what I've been doing, and this addresses a little bit the issue of how do you teach computational science in a way that's maybe not driven by a particular discipline. So I've settled on, of course, this is completely obvious given my background, somewhat discipline-free study of these chaotic, complex, and pattern-forming, self-organizing systems. Why? Well, because they're examples that go back to the three-body problem in astronomy in the 1900s that led to much of the mathematical work, but they apply to population dynamics and ecology and evolution. I have people from neuroscience coming in. So these models and the way we think about complex systems apply very, very broadly. So they are a particularly nice class of study system, virtual study system. They're very easy to program. Sometimes only two or three lines of code generates very complicated behavior. They don't build in the type of modeling assumptions that you would learn in a mathematical statistics course, that something's Gaussian, or even if you're sort of very progressive, long-tail distributions, that kind of thing. They actually generate very, very complicated and a priori not understood correlation structures. So they're a great case for studying, in particular, for studying how what is traditionally taught as statistical modeling, how it fails miserably. So I think that's a great thing to appreciate, especially if you're going to go on and do research. So the particular thing I wanted to mention was a graduate course I teach in essentially theoretical physics. It's the physics of information and the physics of computation. It's a two-quarter sequence down at UC Davis in physics, but I get students from all over campus, even from psychology coming in, because they want to learn some of the material in this. In terms of educational changes I've made to it, so this last year I finally moved the whole course onto the web, actually into a browser. Why? Because I'm just fed up with operating systems and proprietary software. I need something. It used to be the case, and maybe some other people have had this experience, if you're teaching a computational science course, you spend the first 2 weeks getting the software installed on Windows 7, XP, Linux, Red Hat, Ubuntu, you name it, you know, Mac OS X, whatever version. So moving this on to into a browser has been fantastic. But why do that? Well, I also need a framework in which I can do numerical, symbolic, visualization, and also put the sort of mathematics in there. So what we decided to use was something called SAGE. It is a kind of a Frankenstein package, actually sort of championed at UW for teaching, as far as I can tell, introductory mathematics and calculus. And it lets you do all of these different things. So think of a Mathematica-type notebook where you have the text. You can even do the mathematical equations in LaTeX. You have computational cells from which you can do symbolic manipulations and analytical calculations. You can put up plots, these things can even be in three dimensions and are interactive. This class, again, it's a graduate theoretical physics class. It's completely online now in the sense of homeworks and labs are put up under SAGE. They're handed in by email. They're graded and handed back all electronically. So this has been a huge win, and I don't have to spend the weeks getting everyone up and running on four different operating systems or having to run four different operating systems on my laptop. So that's been a huge win in terms of time. SAGE has issues. It's a very awkward and very large package, sometimes difficult to install on a server. So the way I'm going to be shifting the class, maybe this goes first to teaching technique. This next year, I'm going to videotape and basically webcast all the lectures. Why? Because I found, as I've introduced more of these interactive labs through a browser, that is a more effective use of my time and it's a more effective learning experience. So my plan is everyone's going to hopefully do the reading beforehand, each class. They'll maybe work through the labs a little bit and watch the lecture. And then in class, we go to the board, we go to the laptop, and together solve problems. So the hypothesis is that sort of semi-one-on-one, but at least kind of concrete problem solving with the instructor will be more effective at kind of sort of burning in the techniques and ideas I'd like to get across. Probably going to shift, and I noticed a couple of lectures mentioned this, shifting over to the IPython notebook, has the same sort of integration features. Math, LaTeX, Python running, plotting, nice interactive visualization. One thing it's currently missing, and so this is a very specific call for help or for someone to go help support the few people that are developing the notebook. They don't have the educational support in terms of accounts and subdirectories and so on. SAGE, by the way, does have that. The system, SAGE system, has a way of every student gets an account. They have their own area to work in. Slightly awkward because there's only sort of a flat file system underneath that. You don't get to do home, you know, week one, week two, week three subdirectories, so that's a bit awkward. But the IPython notebook looks very lightweight compared to SAGE. Much more attractive interface, also very thin in terms of its more efficient use of Python and computing resources. Another aspect of this, which is not quite, it's part of my class, can't be brought online, and this is what I was talking about on Tuesday, is immersive visualization. These complex nonlinear systems require developing a geometric, call it visual intuition, about the structure of solution sets. We're no longer doing closed-form solutions. And so what we've been doing is, and this is maybe to the few people that were here in the previous days, we've taken a rather sophisticated cross-platform visualization package written in C++. It goes from laptops up to a full immersive cave room and wrapped it all in Python. So now you can actually sit down and script OpenGL and graphical objects. And so we're turning that into a tool to use for illustrating the various kind of complex systems. In addition, there's another interesting proof of concept we have. Maybe some of you are familiar with what's called live programming. You can be sitting down in an editor, and as you change maybe a slider for the color of your red blob, turning it to blue, it instantaneously changes. So now we have a live programming interface to our immersive visualization facility. So you can throw up 100 spheres and have them all sort of dancing around and change the animation in real time as you're looking at your code. And it's just tremendous fun. It's sort of like, I always wanted to program this way. So this is all open source. It'll be out there on the websites down at UC Davis. And so that's kind of my response to teaching some computational science ideas and informatics methods.
Can we ask a question?
Oh, sure.
So do you get sort of feedback from or evaluation of the impact of this? So if much more is being out there, you've got less sort of direct contact with the people at the receiving end. So how are you getting feedback that the people at the receiving end are actually doing the prep work? Is it all through, if you like, practical sessions and the feedback from that?
Well, of course, most major universities, there is the evaluations that get handed out at the end of every course, so I get feedback through that. But slightly self-aggrandizing, I've gotten extremely positive feedback from the students themselves. I have people that just go to the course websites and lectures and labs and are just doing it. I haven't even organized it as if it were a Coursera presentation yet. And I'm getting feedback from people just by email saying, I learned Python this way. That's really great. So far, it seems pretty positive.
So you think they are actually learning?
Yes.
Because
yes.
Can imagine that people would say, oh, it's great, because they don't have to physically turn up, get a crawl out of bed at the right time, and these sort of things.
Yeah.
But it's a bit like you hear that MIT are having these sort of open courses, and you think, well, when it's a normal graduate course, you get exams at the end of it, and what the progress is, what the outputs are, and so forth. And with these ones, where it's a bit more ad hoc.
Yeah, somehow there's the kind of that broad reach. The AI course at Stanford goes out to 100,000 people, but maybe only 20,000 actually completed. And who really did it anyway? And who's correcting all those homeworks? You don't have enough TAs. I'm kind of traditional. I actually my focus is really in the classroom, one-on-one with students, and that's how I check that they're learning. Putting it out there, I like that. I like that. That's great. And I'm sure there will be some people for which that's just exactly the right kind of self-study thing, and they'll do well. I will never know. I will never know. But that's fine. I worked at the San Francisco Exploratorium, kind of an interesting, very interactive science museum for a number of years. I did a show called The Turbulent Landscape, had 30 exhibits, and that toured around the country and actually in Europe for about 5 or 6 years. The estimate was 4 million people saw the show. And after lecturing at Berkeley for years, like, my God, I could lecture till I was blue in the face and never reach that many people. I have no idea what their experience was, but I just kind of trust that there was some, at least, some sort of communication of the basic ideas of complex systems out there.
This brings up an interesting point of lecturing personally to students versus students finding content on the internet. I think it's inevitable, and it's a good thing, that more and more high-quality educational content is going internet, even with Coursera and whatnot. But there is that final part of educational process that comes in an interaction and so on. I think that's where professors' time should be spent. This is why people would pay to attend university as opposed to just sit at home and watch videos on their computer. Yeah.
It's the dilution of quality at some level.
No, I mean, it's like anything else. You can have it high, you can have it low. I think there are numerous sociological and practical issues here don't need to bother with. But that's one of the ideas that I think we need to explore, the optimal splitting of the content delivery, which can be very efficiently done online, versus educational gelling process that comes from interactions of students between themselves and with the teacher and so on, which does not scale so easily. And yet we have a need to try to improve scaling of that as well in some fashion.
So if we can carry on, let Andy share his thoughts with us. Yeah.
Okay, can I make one comment? It's pertinent to what George just said. A long time ago, in fact, 1994, I taught a course that was offered on all campuses of the University of California. It was a small, fairly focused graduate seminar, and so there were about 15 people total, with a few from each campus. And the interesting thing was that one of the students from Berkeley was also taking a communications course. And in that course, she wrote a paper about my course. And she surveyed all the students to get this feedback as to, how they felt. And the interesting conclusion was that I've never met this student, and yet she feels she knows me as well as she knows some of her other professors. We've only talked on the phone and communicated by video conference, which in those days was picture tell, which is a fairly primitive system. She said what she missed and what the other students said that they missed was the interaction with the other students in the course. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. No problem.
Please.
Okay. So I think based on what we've been saying so far, a lot of us are saying the same sort of thing. This is something we've been struggling with for 4 or 5 years. At least. So what I thought I'd do is I'd just spend a couple of minutes and talk about what are the directions going on at UW at the moment, what are we thinking about in terms of trying to prepare for the next generation of surveys. And it's not just astronomy. At the University of Washington, we have the Ocean Observatory Initiative, which includes a project that I think used to be called Neptune, which is oceanography, having large amounts of data coming off and having to process that either in real time or archive it and process it later on. And what we've been trying to do is to work out there's a commonality between astronomy, some of the genetic analyses that people have been doing, and oceanography. And when we started thinking about this, we found that there were three or four areas that you can break it down into. The first one is we did a survey of students at the University of Washington and said, and postdocs, what do you spend most of your time doing? And they said, with a ratio of 9-1, most of the time that they spend is in wrangling the data, you know, changing the formats of the data, getting the data to interact with other data, working with data, putting their own data and doing the data management of their own data. And clearly that's not a good operating mode if most of your time is actually working on how to put a data in a format that you want to do the analysis with. The second aspect was that when we think about machine learning, we haven't been training people in how to undertake different machine learning techniques. We don't get a good background in statistics. And so we need to have ideas about how do you do the scalable analyses. And the classic example of this is if you have a factor of 1,000 increase in data, which is what you go from SDSS to LSST, if you are taking an hour to analyze SDSS data, we're now talking about thousands of hours. And there's timescales of interaction with data which go from fractions of a second, which you're used to when you're working on a video game, through to a handful of seconds when you're doing an interactive analysis and you want to get the results back, through to, if we don't do anything about it, we're looking at weeks, if not months. And that changes how you do all of the science. The third aspect is data modeling. A lot of the analyses that we need to work on with projects such as LSST is that the statistical uncertainty is dropping dramatically. And that means most of the limitations on our ability to do the science are going to be dominated by the systematics within the data. And with the particular problem, you have a lot of heavy-tailed functions. So you have long tails to the distributions, which have large amounts of uncertainties. You have likelihood functions that are multimodal. And so how do you actually propagate that information through? And then the last thing that we've heard about, I think, from about at least three of the previous speakers is the idea of collaborative science. And we'll talk a little bit about this, and we'll try and show some demonstrations of this over the next few days, where we can show how you can do analysis within a browser, how you can share that information with someone on the other side of the country, and they can pick up the same visualization that you left off, say, at 5 o'clock in the evening. They can pick it up in the morning, the next day, continue working on it, and you can get the results back. We'll show you some of the techniques associated with that in the visualization school. So what are we trying to do at UW? We have an eScience Institute. Alyssa talked about the institute that was set up at Harvard. The eScience Institute at UW has been focusing on placing computationally literate people into different departments to try and bring up the individual departments, increase their computational literacy. And the idea behind that is to have a lot of shared expertise. We're running using the, I don't know how many of you are aware of software carpentry. I think it originally came out of, was it MIT that it came from? Is it Toronto? Toronto. So we have courses based from software carpentry. They come in and teach the basic ideas of thinking about software as a skill, right? And how you actually use that. And then we are developing certification programs which are cross different disciplines that provide the core underlying curricula that you need to use these techniques in analytics and wrangling, data wrangling, modeling within different science components. A part of this we're trying to start up is an IGERT program. But I think one of the other aspects that's important is this connection with industry.
And so developing internships so that you can go out to Microsoft, or you can go out to Yahoo, or you can go out to Google, or to any of the local technology companies. And this is an example of this. Tableau, which Alyssa mentioned, is local to Seattle. And this is an interactive visualization company. And so you can go out and see what is the direction, what are the directions that different companies are going into. And the important aspect is most of these products that you get don't work off, they don't just work out of the box. You can't just go and throw your data at them. You have to learn how they work and all of their idiosyncrasies. So what I just wanted to end with were two things. One is, this isn't just driven by the universities. The state legislature at the University of Washington is also pushing for a more quantitative educational program for the undergraduate students coming out. And the second thing I wanted to end with was to say, we have an audience who are struggling with this all the way through, right? So all of the students in the visualization school are either in the midst of trying to learn the tools, or they are a few years out and have learned it in some way or other. And so I was interested in say, Lucianne, just asking you about how did you learn the skills that you need, and what are we doing wrong, right? Because we can talk about it all, and we can talk forever on this stuff. But
yeah,
stretch it apart. What are we doing wrong?
Actually, most of the people in the room don't know me. I'm Lucianne Walkowicz, and although I'm at the kids' table, I'm actually not a graduate student. I'm a postdoc. And I know Andy through and several other people through my involvement in LSST, where I chair the Transients and Variable Stars collaboration. And I guess the answer to Andy's prompt is, you know, that I'm actually here because I'm attempting to retroactively learn the skills that I need. I learned to program because my undergrad advisor handed me the Intro to IDL book and said, we need a program that can spectral type all the low mass stars in SDSS. Write it. And I don't know if you've ever seen the IDL handbook, but it's really crappy and it's a terrible way to learn to program. And you know, I like had minimal exposure to programming before that, but you know, I never learned any of these principles. Like, I now, because of the way that we learn to program as astronomers, we have a certain amount of I guess institutional inertia, in that often when you learn to program, it's because you inherit code from somebody before you. And that means that there's many, many years of, you know, things that are written in Fortran and IDL and things that essentially are a museum to the past programming bad habits of our predecessors as we pass these things down. And so, you know, even now, many of my collaborators use IDL. I would like to move over to using Python, and I am basically teaching myself Python in my non-copious spare time because, you know, I have all this code, but it represents basically a diversion away from my ability to be scientifically productive and to produce papers to actually port that stuff over into another language that will be more practical. And so, you know, I think it's really great that we're thinking about all of this, but we have to realize that a lot of this stuff is really ingrained, and there has to be some channel, not only for us to learn this stuff on the side and for this to be something for the next generation, but if the previous generation doesn't learn to do this stuff, and I'm including myself in that previous generation, if we don't actually take the time to learn these things, then our students will suffer the same way that we have already. And so that's it's a real challenge because it does actually represent taking a step away from your research and devoting it in something that, you know, is worthwhile, but does take time. You know, as I'm looking at all of these slides that are up there, another thing that pops to mind is that this is an alternate career path for a lot of people who either are undergrads or graduate students in astronomy. You know, we don't like to think about the fact that one day we may grow up and not actually be faculty members at an R1 research institution in an astronomy department. But, you know, numbers-wise, that's not going to happen for most people. And, you know, that's not necessarily a bad thing because we actually do have a lot of really applicable skills, but we don't foster this as a possible outcome. And one of the things that I think about sometimes is that actually, you know, for years we've had graphic designer firms, for example, you know, that specify a topical area. So, you know, they work on some particular aspect of advertising, for example. You could imagine that there would be basically data visualization and analytics firms that would be independent operators that would allow you to work on topics that you're interested in. So you could have a whole shop full of astronomers who are versed in this stuff and are capable of working on individual projects to apply these skills both to their own research and to other things in a way that would actually present a viable way of feeding yourself in the future. So...
We have slides from each one of us. I want to have people who have the slides and then have opportunity to talk through it, and then we have more discussions. How's that?
Yeah. You got to take control.
Then I'm taking the control, and I want Kirk to speak the next. I'm sorry.
I guess I'll follow Andy's example. It's good to be up in the front of the room and waving my arms. I really like Lucien's comments there. Besides having the slide up here, I was thinking of a few other things that I could say that sort of extend that introduction of myself from half an hour ago, and that is I am part of the LSST project as well in two fairly major capacities. One is the chairman of an informatics and statistics science collaboration team, where we are looking at ways that we can infuse these concepts of data science, informatics, and statistics into the scientific research program of LSST. And also, another major area where I work with that project is in the education program. And to me, it's sort of the two come together, because what we have very powerfully in astronomy is very visual data products, specifically the images that come out of astronomy. But I think even more, we can present interesting discoveries from astronomy in ways that are not necessarily pretty pictures, but even sort of graphical discovery, and especially some of the stuff we saw this morning from Alyssa Goodman, where there's really dynamic grand tours and fly-throughs of high-dimensional data that could actually be pretty interesting in a classroom and pretty interesting on, for example, public broadcasts of science that sometimes we see on the television. So sort of blending data science as a way of discovery or learning from big data for science and for education is sort of where I find myself camped, one foot in each of those categories. And thinking about what Hussein was just saying about the guaranteed employment, if you do this stuff, I was at another conference last week, which was run by the Wolfram Corporation, so Stephen Wolfram, who created Mathematica, and they have their Wolfram Alpha search engine. If you've never tried that, it's actually a computational engine, does pretty interesting things. We saw an example yesterday where a person just types into the search box M51 Redshift, and instead of just finding web pages that have those two words on it, it actually returns the redshift of the galaxy M51. So, or you say population European countries, it won't just find web pages with those three words. It'll actually present a table of numbers with the names of the countries and their populations. So it's actually very interesting. So I was at this conference, and Wolfram sponsored the last 3 years this Big Data Summit. And there's people from all walks of life there. I mean, not just scientists. I mean, people from federal agencies, major international corporations. I mean, Dun & Bradstreet, MasterCard, plus a huge number of startup people, like people from Twitter, Yelp, and a lot of other things you've probably heard of and use sometimes. And what shocked me was some of the CEOs and CTOs of these startup companies that we hear about every single day. These people were like 20 years old. I mean, I really felt old in this room. But it was just an amazing amount of creativity and innovation coming in these areas right now. And what sort of the unanimous thing I heard from many of the different people who stood up in front of the room, and I'm not talking about scientists, I'm talking about business people. They said, what is the, besides the data science skills, what kind of people are they looking to hire? And they said, physicists. And by that I include astrophysicists in my head. Because why? Why? Because physicists are trained to solve problems and to think critically and think creatively. And so the skills you get as in studying astronomy, studying astrophysics, and including the things we're hearing about this morning, really make you invaluable to a wider community. And so Alex Gray was here yesterday, and he was telling us a story how he was reading some job ad from Silicon Valley. It was a job announcement. He said it'll take anybody who knows Hadoop and knows how to apply it to big data, and the starting salary was $450,000, not yen. Okay. It's like, am I doing the wrong thing right now? I'm at a state university. I haven't had a raise in 7 years. I mean, am I doing, no. Anyway, so the slides tell sort of a little bit of my pitch. Okay, so I call this, my last name is Bourne, so this is the Bourne ultimatum here. data science for the masses, or sometimes I say data literacy for all. And I have these sort of two perspectives on it. One is the one we've been hearing about this morning already, is how do we teach data science to our scientists. Okay, so giving people an education in data science, an education in how to analyze, mine, access, model, deal with large data. But the opposite part of that angle is, which actually Robert Brunner was actually talking quite a bit about in his presentation, was infusing informatics, data science, in all disciplines. And so I teach a course, and several courses, but my freshman course, computational data sciences, I have little segments in that course on computational law, computational humanities, you know, computational art. I tell them how people are using Fourier analysis in paintings to actually determine sort of the spectral signature of artists, how the brush strokes, the width and breadth of the brush strokes helps art provenance people to detect fraudulent paintings, to detect frauds. Okay, and it's done by Fourier analysis, a technique that astronomers learn. Okay, so the application areas can be just about anywhere, and I introduce that to my students, and I'm working, as I mentioned earlier, with the business school now, and we've been talking with the health school and even the School of Education about how we can change education in all places that has infused those courses and training programs with some of this stuff for their students. And so the idea that students learn well when they're actually doing hands-on stuff has been studied by a group at Carleton University, and they actually wrote a little book on the subject of some of their research called Using Data in the Classroom. And it actually is sort of a very interesting a set of guidelines for how to actually engage students, and sort of evidence that shows that students actually do learn better when they're dealing with real data. So in my class, even though it's a science class, I actually introduce what I would call sort of fake social network data. Okay, so it's not real data from Facebook, but I create a little database of fake people and links between them because they like different things. They share certain amounts of likes. And so there's a network there. And we talk about different techniques for exploring those connections, exploring that graph, and to make discoveries from it. Okay, so it's all prepackaged by me, so they actually do find some interesting things in the little toy database that I create. But I show the students in an experience that they have every day, which is dealing with their social network, and almost all of them are sitting there while I'm lecturing, updating their Facebook page or tweeting or something while I'm talking. So I say, hey, you're doing this every day. And the exciting thing for me is they put those devices down because no longer are they doing social networking, they are doing data science in their social network, in the classroom. And so the metric for me is I get the feedback I get from the students at the end of the semester. I mean, it's been transformative. I mean, I had many students come to me and just shake my hand at the last day of class, after the exam, and they said they've never had a class like that. They were amazed with what they could do. And they said, I never knew I could do these things with computers, right? The typical experience of a young person with a computer, again, is updating your Facebook status, okay? Not actually doing real science. And so that's sort of the message of all of this here, so thanks.
Thank you. So I just want you to know that when I was in Moscow State University and when I was at Tsinghua University, they all know you. They all know your courses.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. What? So they mentioned that specifically, and I offered Microsoft Translator that I mentioned to you.
Are you regularly under ITAR?
Am I what?
Am I regulated? I probably should be.
So they're interested in translating your courses, okay. and that's why I was talking to you about perhaps we can use machine translation and convert it as a baseline.
Let's have
that
conversation later. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So I do. I'm gonna just like move on and see which whose slides is available to me next, and then we can do that. And otherwise, we can never have coffee. Jeff, how about you?
Oh, sure. Yeah. So as I said earlier, I'm a guy who studies snow. I'm at the University of California, Santa Barbara. Which is a really good place to think about snow and ice. I'm also I spent the summer here as a visiting researcher. That's why I have a blue badge. I actually like to think of myself as the oldest among the summer interns. And also I gave a lecture a month ago at the Science Institute. So I also like to there's a short essay that I'd recommend to all of you, and it's only 2 pages, so if you don't like it, it's still only 2 pages. And it's called Anti-Disciplinary Science. A-N-T with an E, ante, means before disciplines, and it kind of discussing the idea of how disciplines are created. And one of the things that I think that might be provocative in some universities is I don't think departments should be granting PhDs. I think PhDs should be granted by interdisciplinary institutes that live for 10 or 15 years and then go away and reform. Departments are good in terms of a way to, you know, you have to structure a university hierarchically, but organizing the PhD study around departments, I think is a bad idea. But so one of the, let's see, I've got that menu there that I don't need, actually. Okay. So one of the questions that we talk about in this Astroinformatics Institute is, you know, how do people from different fields work in a collaborative way together? You know, and here I am as a guy who studies snow, and I'm sitting for 4 days in this astroinformatics conference. And so one of the ways I think we benefit by working together is to identify some problems that are generic across disciplines. That if you stay in environmental science, or you stay in astroinformatics, or you stay in physics, you know, what happens, and Max Planck made this observation, that the problems that are both tractable and important get solved pretty early, and that what you're left with are the problems that are really hard or unimportant. And where fields make advances is when somebody comes in from a new angle and typically resets that curve that otherwise gets to a point of diminishing return. And so one of the ways then of doing this is to identify which problems are generic across disciplines, and therefore you can bring in people that have new insights. And so I'd like to present my problem in that context. I was very intrigued by a new phrase that I learned at this meeting, and Mark is not here today, but he brought up the idea of pattern discovery as being distinct from pattern recognition, with the idea that pattern recognition is where you know the pattern you're looking for and you go find it. And pattern discovery is that are there ways of discovering things in data that you weren't necessarily preconceived and were looking for. So here's my problem, and then I'll just describe what it is, and you can think about it, and if you have ideas, you can search for me on the internet. You can Bing me, as I say, since I'm at Microsoft here and not at Google. it goes as follows. I'm interested in forecasting snowmelt runoff, and I'm interested
in doing two things. First, in the places like the Western United States, the methods are based on statistics, and so anything that's based on statistics is going to be right most of the time, but is also going to have a long tail. And so what we find is, you know, the RMSE on the snowmelt runoff forecasts are, you know, tend to have an error of around 20% or so is the median error, and the utility companies can kind of live with that sort of error. But sometimes there are errors of 50 or 60%. So if I were to tell you your salary next year that, you know, it might be 60% lower than it is now, that would, you'd have a hard time dealing with that, right? If we were 60% higher, maybe you'd be okay, right? And the other thing I'm interested in doing is applying the same thing to snowmelt runoff forecasting and glacier behavior in areas where there are no surface measurements, like Afghanistan, you know, where people would shoot at you if you tried to set up a surface network. So I have a method for doing that using remote sensing. I take the measurement of snow cover, which I can do in real time from satellite, and I watch the rate at which it disappears, and I get this map on the right. And those values are pretty good. In other words, if I compare them to surface measurements and I compare them to the water that comes out in the stream, I come pretty close, at least in a, I know that I'm pushing in the right direction. The only problem with that is that that answer comes after the fact. So the water has already flowed down the river when I know the answer to the question. And so it's useful in a scientific context of studying, say, eco-hydrology in the mountain environment, but it does not help with runoff forecasting, right? So the question is, what can I learn from that? That what kind of observations, how can I treat observations that I can make in real time in a way that helps me predict that future? So what can I observe in real time? Well, a couple of things. One is I have topography, which at the scale that I look at things is static, right? So I kind of know what's going on at different slopes that face the sun in different directions. I can measure the area that's covered with snow, and I can do this every day. Yeah, I forgot to mention, this is also, these images are all time series. So I have them for every day. And I have a numerical weather model that I can use to estimate precipitation. And the only problem with that numerical weather model is it has a troubling error distribution. It doesn't pick up the snow at the highest elevations. And in particular, it doesn't actually produce enough water. That, you know, I know that I've got to produce in my model, I've got to have more water than what flowed down the river, because otherwise I don't have anything left over for evaporation. And this model produces less, in many years, produces less water than actually flows down the stream, all right? But on the other hand, you know, it the colors kind of look good, right, in terms of comparison to the right answer. So the question that, you know, I would like to pose as one that probably applies in astrophysics, it probably applies in biology, it is this question of this multidimensional pattern discovery. Is, are there things that we could do by observing this static data and the time series here and comparing them over a range of years with what was a better answer to, in fact, come up with ways that I can use these data, use that knowledge, and correct this model in a way that gives me this answer, but gives me that answer while the snow is still there on the ground. And so, first of all, answering that question would be really useful to me, but I also present it as just a good way to work together among people who are approaching complexity from different viewpoints. So, thank you.
Thank you. So I think I just learned how to rephrase my question earlier about data mining. I'm really asking people about, do you mean that you are looking for pattern recognition or pattern discovery?
Yeah.
So the faster search that I presented earlier at George's Digging Deeper, I think those workshops, about faster search and about pivot view that I presented, that's really about discovering something surprising embedded in the data. So you do data mining, you try to find out what the science is embedded in the data.
Well, the short answer, there's both of those are data mining. One is supervised learning, one is unsupervised.
Right.
Pattern discovery is unsupervised, and pattern recognition is essentially classifying a pattern that you're looking at.
No. Wonderful.
Well, anyway.
No. We have 10 minutes left. How do we do this? Let's see. I have Ashish. And then Nicholas, you have a slide, and then Dr. Trey has a slide.
Well, Pepe has it. He's been wanting to say something, and it sounds like it's short. So.
She's a, yeah. It would be strange to be called in a panel and then not even speak. I just am worried about one thing very quickly. Do you want to be an astronomer or become an astroinformatician? On average. You want to become an astronomer in the future or astroinformaticians? Most of you. Are you astronomers?
Good question.
So it's a mixture. So because my feeling is that we're missing one thing, which is the astronomical side. Because the problem is that I teach in a faculty of physics in Europe, where at these things we can devote at most 16 credits. So I would like to, I expect from this panel, the definition of the minimum set of knowledge which an astrophysicist need to know in order to exploit these technologies when he will need it in its everyday work for the PhD thesis and so on. And since the amount of things to be taught is huge, I think this is a crucial point, because if there are astronomers in this school, I am afraid that most of them, when you go to most technical things, won't understand a word of what you are saying, and they will just go through the lesson staring at the blackboard saying how beautiful it will be to understand these things, but I would have needed a course in parallel programming, or I would have needed someone who had taught me what a cloud is, what a grid is, where it is a difference between the two, what is a web service, what is a web application, and so on. So I think that if we want really to address the problem of the astronomical community, this should be our first target. Not all universities, not all astronomers in the world will be able to access first-class master courses in astroinformatics like those given at George Mason, or we really should think what we can do at the undergraduate level. So to have a minimum set of requirements which need to be taught in order to lead to this career.
Yeah, I do love the discussions going on now, but I wanted to share something very important. This morning, the other group, that's the VAO group, ate our breakfast, which is better than theirs. I don't want that happen again for coffee break. So I suggest that we take the coffee break and then continue this presentation mixed with discussion.
That's fine.
Is that okay?
That's good, yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Just a joke. So VAO people are welcome to enjoy the lunch and the coffee all together.
They're welcome to enjoy the leftovers. That was the subject.
So
let's
we should
let
have...
Let me just
pass. Yeah.
Right.
So I put on this page a link to the PDF of that anti-disciplinary science article that several people recommended. Also, I should mention that several years ago, Jan organized a few workshops about computational education for scientists. Sadly, it's exact same issues that we're discussing now. Several good white papers were prepared, and they're published in a little booklet that's downloadable for free from her website, and I put link to that also on Astroinformatics Facebook page.
Great.
Welcome back, everybody. We will have a few more of these five-minute, one-slide presentations, and we really mean 5 minutes, not 15. Before that, let me reinforce what was already said. We have actual goal for this workshop, and the goal is to come up with a specific set of requirements of the kinds of skills that must be present in a modern astroinformatics curriculum, and we're hoping to distill the contributions we got in discussion here into a short white paper that will contain that description. It'll probably be posted on AstroPH, and just to serve as a guidance. So that's one tangible thing that will come out of all this. To that, I'll just add that a specific thing that we could start here that would be really helpful is to organize a forum for sharing of astroinformatics curriculum materials online of some sort. So with that, I think we'll resume our sequence of 5 minutes. Pepe, you want to start? No, he has no slide. You're next.
Ashish, you want to go? I don't know. It's confused today.
You warm up the crowd?
Yeah, it's confused today. So it's actually, but this one, it's
your slide.
Yeah. Come on, please. Really, it's already there. Well, I had a few slides. So the okay. The let me do like that. You see, it's not convenient. Oh no! Come on.
Oh, you didn't submit your.
No, it's here. It's on the pen. We need the Jan, I think. She knows where you put.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the Ashish. Cover my slides. I don't know where they are.
The thanks a lot. Sorry.
No, exactly.
So what did you do to my slide?
Wrangled it. I think it's a direct link from whatever
page you had up there. So if you just click the link, you'll get it. So you should be able to click that.
You got to go to slideshow mode.
Yeah.
Slideshow.
Yeah.
Current slide.
Yes.
There you go. Now click it. Oh.
What is page up. Probably a control click on it will get you in.
Okay. Let me sort this.
Is it not open on my PDF?
Open
up the app. Read thing. Do open recent.
Yeah.
Right there. It might even be.
There it is. Okay.
Now do control L.
And this is the state of our interfaces.
Right. So I'm going to speak a little bit about gamifying problems for crowdsourcing, something that is coming in vogue very fast. Already we have several systems and so on. But before that, I'll touch on a couple of points that were mentioned by Andy and Lucian about some very basic things that one should know about computing. So last time when I was doing the astroinformatics course, we asked the students how many of them know how to type HTML by hand, and no one did. And that is something that, those are the kinds of things that what's happening these days is that people are into GUIs a lot. But if you know a basic that is behind all these things, that's very useful. And same thing goes with what Andy mentioned about various operations that one has to do with data. Simple things like cutting specific columns, getting specific rows, and so on. So many people know about SQL, and they can do it in SQL, or they can write Python programs, and so on. But there are many Swiss knives available within Unix, like SED and awk. And it's great if you know those kinds of tools, because then you can do many, many things rapidly. So I think the computing-related education has to begin with some basic tools that have been around for a long time and are very, very versatile. But coming to gamification specifically, what's happening is that something like Galaxy Zoo did a great thing. And one of the main reasons for that was the images that you could see of galaxies are something that people can immediately relate with, and they're interested in it, including the general public and so on. But there are many, many problems in astronomy that we can use a lot of help from the masses. But many times it's difficult how to convert that into something that we can translate to, something with which they can connect to and try to help us with. But the main aim should really be is not just taking help from them as just extra cycles of their neurons, but be able to learn from what they're clicking, why they're doing certain clicks, and be able to convert that into additional machine learning tools that we can make that happen much faster. So that is the kind of thing that I have in mind here. And so the left hand notes the tasks that exist and what will be needed on the right hand side. And again, connecting to what Robert Brunner said earlier, many of these tasks, if one is able to do these through various courses and so on, they will immediately make you more marketable. You can definitely use all these tasks elsewhere. So I think with that, I'll stop.
Thank you. Yeah.
So did we get a question?
So, right,
so you're crowdsourcing. So where's your crowds?
Well, that's what, right? Meaning if you make your problem good enough, if it is marketable enough, and if you can do the proper advertising, one of the bullets that I list there, then they will come. So the way Galaxy Zoo did it is that they announced it in various places, including sites that were existed at conferences and so on. So people know, or take protein folding, for instance, even that was announced in many, many locations, so all kinds of advertising will have to be done. So it will have to be told. Before that, there were other kinds of crowdsourcing phenomena, which were not really crowdsourcing, but more computer sourcing, where they used only the cycles of the computers, not really the neurons of people like SETI at home, and even the Mersenne primes, where all that you could do, you'll get a set of numbers, and your computer will work on it and try to give the feedback back to whoever was running the code. So by word of mouth, by blogs. With blogs and Facebook and so on, it's easy to do that, but it will have to be done very aggressively for various markets because there are many, many competing programs too. But I think the main thing is that it has to be catchy. It has to be something that they can connect with, and they understand that if they play a small part in the whole thing, then it's going to be, the returns are going to be big for everyone.
I was just a little bit confused. So on one hand, you're talking about how to build a crowdsourcing platform or project, and it seems what you're saying on the slide here is how to teach. What would be a curriculum to teach people how to build crowdsourcing?
That's right. So because I don't have just astronomy in mind here, but if I'm in a specific, say, subfield of astronomy or a multidisciplinary field or something else completely like biology, what are the steps that one will need to translate that particular problem into crowdsourcing so that one can make use of the general public to help us with that. So yes, that the right-hand side is what will be needed, and if those courses exist, then we can have many, many such programs. And presumably what will happen is that the crowd may be split, but there are enough number of people, and then if it doesn't take too much time, then they can get into it a lot. I think there's...
So,
go ahead. Sorry. This is a comment as it relates to Galaxy Zoo. I would kind of object to Galaxy being classified as a game. Now, we've experimented with game-like aspects to the project, but it's not a game. You can't advance in it. You get no more. You don't go up levels. You don't get anything really for having done more galaxies than someone else. You don't get any reward for being better at classifying galaxies than someone else.
But other people have made a game of it because other, so it's this ecosystem of users now, aren't there? You know, like league tables of who's done this, that.
It's self-generating, though.
I agree that Galaxy Zoo is not a game in itself, but what I do mean is that if we try to capture the elements of game, then it will become much more advertisable. Not, for Galaxy Zoo, it was not needed because, again, the galaxy images were wonderful, but I work on transient classification, and one transient looks like a star, so does the other. It's a point source. And so what you have to be able to do is bring in additional resources. And then if one can make it into a game, and people are into gaming. I mean, if you look at all the games that students are playing on their Facebook or whatever kind of computer, you know that even if it's a silly game and that doesn't do anything, they want to do it. So if we could only convert things into games, then it's going to get a lot of traction. So.
A good game, something right. That looks good and that is interesting.
Yeah.
And so that is often, I think as you're pointing out, something that astronomers are not necessarily good at. So there are a couple projects where we've put in game-like elements, but I think one of the broad conclusions is that it has to be fairly well designed, otherwise no one's going, if they play a game for 2 minutes and it's not good.
Right.
And they're going to cut up this tangent right now and go back to the main theme of this workshop.
And so just one comment. So in the curriculum, there are a lot of things that happen, like when stars are given when you read a book. It is a gamification, but that gamification is really for what you get immediately, instant gratification only. And that is what needs to be taken out of whatever interfaces are built.
Thank you very much. Well, since Jan is not here, I cannot open my slides, but at least I can draw from them. I think that, that games... are something, in the sense Ashish is speaking, are something different from Galaxy Zoo. Galaxy Zoo is a wonderful public outreach tool, but it's not a teaching tool. Tell me what you can ask to a student after that he has spent 3 months on Galaxy Zoo. He has just classified 1,000 galaxies, and you say, well, how did you like them? It's not a teaching tool. The problem which other things are games, and they can be transformed in teaching methods. I want to go back for a second to what I said before. I have a problem. Okay, by the way, it's not true that courses online will not change completely the way each of us teaches. For instance, in Europe, it's recent, the news, there is a consortium of universities who has decided to adopt Coursera. And then if there will be the course given by Bishop on machine learning on Coursera, a student will prefer to take a course given by the father of a neural network or by me. So we have to take this into account. In the future, the online courses will become more and more dominant. They will change completely the way we are teaching. This will be much faster than what we think. For the moment being, I have a very specific problem, which is shared, I think, by most of the students here. I have students who come from physics, from mathematics, from computer science, for astronomy, since I am in this transversal group. And I need to give them the basics. So, what are these basics? It's a complex story. If you make the list of what has been said here, we have infrastructures. So students should learn computer infrastructure, networking, web service, web applications, and so on. Programming, at least one advanced language programming, Java or Python, you choose. Plus some specific like MATLAB or Mathematica or other things. Plus specific application, which are IDL, which is DEM or other things. Then they have to learn the methodologies, because they cannot use blindly the program. They have to learn advanced statistics. Eric Fagelson here, who was here yesterday, would surely agreed on this. They have to do the basic statistics, but also some advanced statistics. Then they have to learn foundations of machine learning. Then visualization, semantics, new communication skills, and so on. So at the end, you have exhausted the 180 credits. Where do these people learn astronomy? Where do they learn physics? Most of the people who enter into an astronomy curriculum enter because they want to become astronomers. They don't want to become computer scientists. Also another thing, we are good at selling. We say, well, with this skill, they enter the industrial world of software if they do not succeed as astronomers. There is nothing new in the last 25 years. Even when I was not yet in machine learning, all my students who did not succeed to become astronomers entered software houses just because we have the good practice to teach them how to program. So I would like to be very careful about that. Then one third consideration. We have been asking money to the national agency saying that the virtual observatory was intrinsically democratic because all what was needed was a network connection, and everyone in the world could access this huge ocean of data which was out there. To do what? If we are saying from the beginning that massive data sets are the future. So what if I do to a Kenya student the possibility to access the data and they cannot do anything because he has not the possibility, not even the foundations of the tools which you need to work on this data. I understand the perspective of who is in LSST or who is in Gaia. I am in Euclid. I'm doing the data mining for Euclid. But that is my perspective. I'm just throwing the water toward myself, and basically I'm just advertising what they do. The problem is more general. And what I expected from such a meeting was something different. That may be my fault. I wanted to know what we considered as a community, the minimum set of skills which had to be taught to students in general, because this means to touch the ministries, to define in the teaching environment, which is a minimum set of skills, and so on. How to insert these skills into a normal curriculum, where in the best case we can dedicate to this topic, if we make a real revolution, 16 credit, no more than that. In 16 credit, that thing you do, okay, this is web service, this is web application, this is it, you don't go much more. So to establish a set of priorities. There is one just last consideration. There is a problem of different backgrounds. I asked before, there is a computer scientist, there is an astronomer. I think that what they have to do, they have to spend 6 months together in order for the computer scientists to understand what the magnitude is and why astronomers have such stupid way of measuring fluxes. Right. Okay. While the astronomers, I'm sure, are staring at... I have been teaching in many of these schools, and I have been also victim when I was younger of many of these schools, staring at the screen saying, well, look, that must be wonderful, but what in the hell is it? School can be useful to arise to curiosity. Schools can be useful to present the problem to the people. But schools are completely useless because for learning, because in 15 days you are there staring at an avalanche of things falling on you and having the feeling to be an absolute idiot. So don't worry, if you have this feeling during the school, it's not your fault. We all have gone through this. Because you don't understand 90% of the things which are said. So the problem is how to teach these things at the lower level, at the level of the masters, undergraduate, to begin at undergraduate, and how to build a path. And I thought that this was the reason for this talk. I'm done.
All right. Anybody to challenge this one?
Here is the mic. We have lost our moderator.
Do you have a slide?
Yeah, I've got a slide.
All right.
Don't know where it is. It's on there somewhere.
Yeah,
that's
Ashish's.
Yeah, he's done. He was quick. Yeah.
And we almost had a discussion on crowdsourcing and what you have to do, but it diverged from the focus of the thing. So I just put this. Yeah, I want a control L there, please. You've got to learn control L.
Thank you.
And I also want to get rid of that really annoying little box up there.
Thank you.
Right. Perfect. So, I didn't really know what the education thing was, actually. Nobody sort of mentioned the astroinformatics focus, so apologies, it's slightly divergent, but it's probably worth just saying so that we sort of reflect that by about 12 years old, you've sort of lost your interest in science. Well, these are the studies in the UK, but I think it's probably the same in most of the Western world, probably a lot of other places, and therefore inspiring younger
students, I think, is quite a good place to get involved. But I think the people who are doing it now are actually the good people to go out into schools. And some of the things we're doing in Cambridge do involve our graduate students to get involved in the, if you like, the outreach to primary schools and the younger bits of secondary schools. In UK, Key Stage 3 is a key area. Also, there are, and I think this is also a picture across probably America and Europe at least, and in the UK, they've worked out that teaching kids what they call ICT, information communication technologies, actually involves teaching them how to use Excel and how to log on to Facebook and how to update your status, but it doesn't tell you a lot about any sign of an underlying programming language. Now, they're starting to say that actually, and you really only learn about programming languages in the UK once you do the A-level courses, which is 16 to 18 primarily, and then you only really learn about programming language if you actually do computing. And the way it goes with the education system, if you want to get into a top-rate UK university, you have to be a bit careful with the sort of courses you do at A-level, and usually you want to do what you might call a traditional course, like physics or chemistry or maths, where generally you do not get any actual exposure to computing languages per se. You have to do computing, which if you're not very careful, that's not always seen as a good course to do. So there is a little bit of educating, if you like, the universities when they're looking at their intakes as to what's worthwhile to do. But anyway, just to go back a little bit, I think educationalists are starting to, and politicians are starting to realise that just teaching people how to update their status on Facebook and how to open a web page is not always such a great idea, and that you do perhaps need to expose people to a little bit more computing in terms of scripting languages, Python, these sort of things at a younger age. And the trick is how to actually get that in there. And can you use examples such as you know, new data sets or new missions that actually inspire people to perhaps take the trouble to use some of these techniques to work with that data? So I guess things like the Galaxy Zoo example is quite nice one in some ways, in it's sort of things that can inspire people to actually get on, log on and do something, interact with computers. But can you actually get them to write a little script, for instance, that does something a little bit more sophisticated, and to embed that into somewhere where it pops up in a few areas like maths, English and computing, those sort of things. And I think just to go through that, it is something we are looking at in the Gaia ESA project, so at a European sort of level, reflecting that we will have this amazing data set, and some of it's quite complex to perhaps understand at a younger level, but I think it can actually connect with, you know, the concept of dynamics in the solar system, the concept of supernovae in the sky and so forth. So we are looking at how to get this into and provide this material in that environment, and using some of the technologies such as, you know, Scratch that was generated by MIT. Actually, have we got any of those MIT sort of people here? And some of the sort of nice little hardware platforms like Raspberry Pi you might have heard of. Is that generated over here? Anyone's consciousness? Has anyone picked up? It's like a little $25 sort of computer. It's a little ARM chip, basically. But you can get these things, you can run Scratch on it, you can set it up, you can plug it into a TV, and sort of kids of 12 can do this, and it's really nice sort of thing. And if you've got some astronomy examples running on that sort of technology, it's really, really nice. And I think probably it's the sort of thing that Microsoft have seen as an opportunity to do something there as well. And I think just to comment on some of this, that things are basically, you know, that material has got to be accessible. So things like we've heard standard software and hardware stack, you don't really want to obscure things there. Getting it involved with connecting up with the teacher training establishments is pretty important, because you've got to teach the teachers, basically. Teach the people who teach the teachers, otherwise you can't get through. George is going to cut me off in 2 seconds, so
no, minus 5 minutes.
Minus 5 minutes even, right. And just these other things, basically, this simple is best business, I think, is also. But that probably percolates through to the whole set of discussions we've been having in this, you know, how to get the astroinformatics going through. And I think the wide performance, not high performance, is useful.
As you may have noticed right. on the schedule, the title of this workshop is Connecting Research with Computational Science Education. And so we very explicitly aim this at the kind of graduate level or thereabouts. Education is extremely important at all levels, but
it's a much too large subject to address here properly, and that includes outreach in K-12 and so on. That's really important stuff, but we don't have enough time for that. So I'd like to refocus the discussion back to the actual theme of the workshop, which is high level,
teaching future scientists how to deal with huge data sets. Right? So.
Absolutely. So the next one is Dr. Chuang from Chinese Academy of Sciences, focusing on connecting research with education.
Okay, thank you. I provide some input from the developing countries, especially from China. Since some issues take for granted here, or take for granted from our colleges from the EU countries, but the condition is very different from developing countries. For example, toilet paper. If you go to restroom here, you never take toilet paper. But for China, if you rush into the toilet, you find nothing. Yes, that's the difference. So for us, we have our requirements, our prerequisites for the Austrian informatics to research or to teach our students. Yeah, the first one is easy access to global resources, data resources or services. So we need good network connection, network infrastructure and bandwidth. An example here, Alex Zali set up a link for Johns Hopkins University. The bandwidth is 40 gigabytes per second. But for NAOC, the National Astronomical Observatory in China, the total bandwidth for us is only 100 megabytes per second. So it will take us several days to transfer 1 terabyte. So that's the difference. Another, for education in astroinformatics and data intensive science, we need a good curriculum, and we use the curriculum to teach and to teach our teachers. And of course, we need some white papers or blue papers to persuade our officers. So let them know the importance of the astroinformatics. That is the future of the astronomical research. And of course, the curriculum may be better if provided in Chinese. Of course, we can translate from English. And for research, for well-ready data size, we need astronomers or astronomical projects to provide good or full or enough metadata information. And we need help from the virtual observatory projects partners to help us to provide us best practices for reference. And for research and development in astroinformatics, we need a robust backbone or infrastructure. We hope the WIO data access service or our other online services accessible all the time, but not only for demonstration. If you use it, oh, the link is broken. So this is a problem. But if we hope to provide robust service or resources to our astronomers so that they are willing to buy in our efforts, we need much further efforts to make our service and the resources robust, and they can use it all the time, and they hope the interface is friendly. So, down here. Thank you.
That's wonderful. Thank you. So we have like until noon have a discussion, and then like George said, we set this as a new way of practicing as at the Astro Informatics Conference to collect ideas for us to decide what to do next, not only educating students, but educating ourselves. For example, I really want to learn how I can engage Microsoft Research more closely with astronomers. And so these kind of scenarios is my way of learning from you. And so if we could, you know, have some discussions towards that direction, that would be very helpful. That would be the goal of today's session. Hey, you want to grab one?
I was with, you were there too, in an interdisciplinary computing panel financed by, sponsored by the National Science Foundation. I think we could also enlarge a little the problem, because if we discuss about forming astronomers with some understanding of astroinformatics is one thing. If we are talking about forming astroinformaticians, I would prefer to talk about data intensive scientists, which is another problem with a completely different set of questions to address. I mean, like, for instance, which is the weight which needs to be given to the domain, to the specific needs of the domain with respect to the specific needs of the computer science and vice versa. So it's just a question, what are we going to talk about? The first or the second scenario? Hello?
Kirk, go ahead.
So actually, before you even put that book up there, I was thinking of exactly this. There's a table from your workshop years ago in this book that lists the types of courses that should be in such a curriculum.
The software carpentry, and a lot of comments that George making, George was making, is actually collected in this when we had our meeting 5 years ago. I feel we're trying to make a progress.
Right, a lot of it is there, and so when I first became aware of this book, okay, which was at Astroinformatics 2010, so 2 years ago, and I looked at the list of courses recommended for such a program, I felt pretty good, because what we created at George Mason University actually includes pretty much all the things that you said there, which are the computational science, modeling, simulation, visualization, machine learning, databases and data modeling. I don't remember what all they are in this book now, but so I when I think about what should be in such a curriculum, I think about those things. But then there's another part of me that even rebels against what I just said. Even within myself, I'm warring over this. And it's something that Pepe was saying, and that is, if we add all these extra courses to the curriculum, where are our students getting what, you know, the really valuable and important astronomy and astrophysics content in their education? And another way to think about it is, I think back to my astrophysics training as a graduate student at Caltech. There was absolutely no course in computer programming, absolutely no course in statistics, absolutely no course in modeling and simulation. Yet I did all of those things for my thesis. So how did I learn that? I learned it on my own, because I was motivated to learn those things to do the study of colliding galaxies. Okay.
So that's really so broad.
So it's challenging to give the students an education where they will be respected as astronomers, astrophysicists, or whatever discipline you want to plug into that statement, to be respected disciplined scientists in their discipline. They have to have that training.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we know they need this skill set.
But and the training for students or for the teachers?
Both.
So here, one of the points saying that we teach what we know and use. What if ourselves are not using the right tools, for example?
I have a comment that
it's good to hear from people we might inflict anything.
I was just going to say, we might want to do this in small groups with maybe like a handful of students with each of you, and then come back into large group to discuss the white paper, because I'm sure that we have thoughts on this that, that would come out better in smaller discussion.
So George has put it up on the Facebook. If you guys could, you know, making comments on there.
No, you're saying right now.
Yeah. You're saying that right now.
These are nice round tables.
Yeah.
But it's a
so
interesting
because,
idea for half an hour.
Yeah, accommodate that in the following few days.
Exactly.
Well,
no.
Right now.
No, I think right now there is not enough time to do a good job on this. We need another
workshop. You could form the groups, and then to form subgroups on Facebook.
But it was a key point of Kirk's. What gives, basically, in the curriculum? If you're doing this as extra topics, what does it replace? Or how does it evolve into becoming mainstream? So you don't think about this as an add-on, but you see this as a mainstream type activity. And by the time you get to graduate courses, well, in Cambridge we have a few graduate courses in the first year where you get some of these tools, statistics. Usually comes up in statistics as the topic, so this would be adding on to that. But what goes into the undergraduate course? Well, that we heard nicely from Bob Brunner, I suppose, and that's perhaps the most useful thing here.
Did I miss your comments, Pep?
Or what?
You did. When I was
discussing with the microphone, I lost the first part.
We had a pretty lively discussion when you were gone.
Yeah.
I always miss the best part.
I mean, the problem of overburdening students is already with us, even just in pure astronomy graduate curriculum. And every year we agonize, we want to add this, but what else can we take out? And we don't want them to spend 2 years taking classes and so on. So inevitably, I think this will be, you do the very elementary coverage for everybody, and then people have to specialize. You can't expect today that theoretical astrophysicists will really understand how to build instruments or vice versa. And so now we have software instruments and whole other set of skills that are appearing. So unfortunately, human minds being finite and graduate school time being finite, it will end up in some sort of specialization. But intro level, I think everybody will have to take.
So I agree with George, we face this all the time. It seems like one way to think about this is what are the core components that you need to learn to help you when you have to learn everything on your own. And one of them is, how do I design a program? How do I design structures? How do I do the basic computational design? And then the second aspect is, how do I really learn? The way I really learn is I'm sitting next to someone who knows much more about it than I do, whether it's cosmology or whether it's statistics or whether it's something else. And I think sometimes that's what we really lack. That if I was working at a software company, the five people sitting in my cubicle will know much more about C++ or Python or something, and I can go and ask them. And do we have that? How do we bootstrap our way to having that expertise so that the guy in the next office or the woman in the next office knows much more than me? Right.
Yeah, that's so. Actually, if you want to hear a good story of that, that's Alex Zelle and Jim Gray. They happen to know each other. They, very well. They love working together. So World Wide Telescopes produce. Now, a lot of successful at UIUC, when they do this astroinformatics and the other informatics course, it's because in that one building, there's different disciplines, professors having to know each other. So that's very important.
Yeah, but I think that is right on one point. There is a big problem that you have when you try to implement a course in a university which is not heavily oriented toward computer science. And this is that, for instance, if you need to teach the basics, like George was saying, it's an alternative to theory and to experimentals. So take a normal degree in physics. You have the first 3 years courses in mathematics, in experimental physics, and introduction to theoretical physics. If we assume that the data analysis is the fourth leg of science and we have to give the foundation, it's very likely that the guy who is going to teach the foundation of computer science is not an astronomer. And therefore, he will teach what for him are the needed
parts of the theory. At the end up, you end up like, for instance, in the case of foundational theoretical physics. Quantum mechanics is not so important for the astronomy. But we take a huge number of classes in quantum mechanics, and sometimes even in relativistic quantum mechanics, which I've been an astronomer for 40 years, I never used it. The problem is how to build something which is possible, which is not just, you know, the isolate elite thing. It's how to bring astroinformatics like statistics has been brought into courses. I mean, Eric has done a wonderful job because he has been acting at lower level and he has brought astrostatistics at a level which can be taught at each stage of an astronomical course. So I think that the question he raised is very important, how to make these things, how to put these things together.
She has a comment. Yeah. I know, it's terrible. So the real question that I have for you is, are you going to emphasize skills that people are going to need, or are you going to emphasize the way that graduate school shapes your mind into an instrument where you can figure things out? I mean, what Andy is talking about, you know, I sit next to somebody who knows more about this and they mentor me and then I figure it out from them. That's true, but I also have to go back to my own computer and figure it out for myself. The way I learned how to do that was from taking quantum mechanics courses where I had to sit down and actually go through derivations. The question I have for you guys is the next generation of scientists, are their minds going to be shaped in that fashion, or is it going to be more from, I understand how to make code, I understand how to solve problems numerically?
I would say both.
Yeah.
So sometimes, I mean, I had a really scary kind of realization one summer when I had 5 interns working with me, and then half of them are from science discipline and the other half is from computer science. When the biology student talked to the computer science student, he showed the computer science student his code, and the computer science student came to me and said, I didn't say it to him, but those thousands of lines of code, I can do it in the hundredth line of code, and that is not important. What's important is that the biology student didn't know that there is such a thing called lookup table. So he repeatedly creating the same parameters over and over again. And if you create a lookup table from the beginning, which is something basic, you know, very basic training for all computer science students, and then you can do everything the correct way, the efficient, what the computer meant to do for you. So what scared me is that, what if science students didn't know what they're missing? How do we, so I thought that's really about computational thinking. Unfortunately, this term was overused at one time. Now that when you use it, people didn't even want to hear it. But I think computational thinking really is what I wanted to provide to the science students, so they know how to take the true advantage of the computing.
That's what I want you guys to have.
So, you know, one of the disadvantages of being old is that we've been involved in graduate education for 34 or 40 years, and unfortunately, that means we think we know something about it, and
and that is a handicap,
and that's a handicap, and one of the things that I get from Andy's comment and from yours, whose name I don't know, but okay.
the nameless one.
Yeah. Is that that there is a strategy that people need to learn about working together in small groups. That if we really think of some of the, you know, what I think of the great advances of science is that, you know, the Galileos are pretty rare. Mm-hmm. And that most of the advances have come when small groups of people get together and work on things. You know, the structure of DNA is an example. And we don't do as much as we can to help students learn how to do that. Now, some of them teach themselves, but there are things I think we could do to help students do the kinds of things that Andy and Suzanne are talking about. That, you know, if there is somebody that knows more about the problem, I have situations where I know, in terms of the end-to-end problem, I know more about it than anybody does. But at every step along the way, there's probably someone out there who knows more than I do. And the question is how to learn to do that collaboration. And one of the things I think that's pretty easy that people do in some education programs is do things like small group projects. And I would assert that there probably should not, that an individual master's thesis should be rare. You know, that typically master's programs are short. You want them to be short, you know, 1 or 2 years. And having a student in 1 or 2 year, in that short of time, produce a really individual creative piece of work is very difficult. I mean, there are certainly many of counterexamples, but in general, the typical master's thesis is not very useful. It's not a useful exercise for the student, except as kind of a filter for the PhD program, which is how we use them mostly. And it's not really a contribution to the scientific literature, except, again, in very rare instances. But what you can do in a short program, say in a 2-year master's program, is you can have a pretty substantive group project. And, you know, people, not big groups, not big interdisciplinary teams, small interdisciplinary team of 3 to 5 people, and learning how to make progress in that sort of a setting is something that you can teach people how to do, you know, how to handle conflict, how to take advantage of each other's expertise. And so, pardon?
We should come on language.
Exactly. And they have a structured way to learn all these things that Suzanne and Andy have said are important. But basically, you're learning it in an ad hoc way. And I think there's a structured way to do that. And that's what I would do. If I were to do a sort of a general informatics program that would be part of an astroinformatics program, I would think about how to do that.
And we really want to use these questions working out from this session to guide that. You need a focus. Right now I feel like we're encouraging people to do dual diploma or dual degrees. That's not what we want. We just want you to have the skills you need so you can still do science, but better. You have some words. Sorry.
Yeah, I guess I would slightly disagree in that I think actually that small group collaboration is something that grad school teaches us really well how to do. In that we, you know, generally speaking, most advisors have more than one student, and you often end up talking to those people. And the problem with that, and the reason that that hasn't, you know, magically induced computational literacy among astronomers, is that it's the blind leading the blind. And so we don't necessarily have to have students getting a dual degree, but I think Andy's point about design principles is a really good one. And in that sense, I mean, if you learn some of the very basic things, which frankly, you know, 1,000 lines of code versus 100 lines of code is an almost visual example of the amount of time wasted reinventing basic things and doing things in this brute force manner that, you know, could be spent on science. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it seems like, you know, going to Pepe's comment about what is the basic minimum, it seems like the basic minimum should be some at least versing in design principles of constructing code and how you actually apply that, because, you know, you don't want to make somebody's computational education tied to a particular language or anything like that. And you certainly don't need to have them have a separate computer science degree. Students that want to do something like that will do it on their own.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems like it needs to, you know, if you're not going to add a bunch of more burden onto graduate students in their coursework, it seems like you need a basics class, and then for actual computational projects to make up at least a sizable fraction of the homework that is available to you in each class. And that was certainly the case for some of my graduate courses. It's just that, you know, then of course you have the problem that
right.
those computational projects are being laid out by people that maybe don't have that background. But if the students have had some versing in what they should be doing, at least then they can take, you know, okay, you know, construct a model of, you know, XYZ, and they can take those principles that they've learned and actually apply them in an astronomical context that's both teaching them the basic of the astronomy and physics, the basics of the astronomy and physics that they need, and the computer science skills in order to accomplish that.
So in that Transform Science book, we call it problem-based learning, and a few people has kept on doing since we had and been really successful. For example, one of them got the ACM Education Award, actually. It's because they carried on with this problem-based learning. And that's the driving force that I wanted to push for today's session. I want to have the problems that we use in the classroom. So at this point, I would like to have George to kind of summarize all this, and then so we can call this the beginning of some grand, you know, scale kind of discussion, keep the ball rolling, rather than, you know, calling this as the end of the something. So I want to get something started.
Well, I mean, not surprisingly, this is a huge subject and we're just scratching the surface. But we were hoping to come up with something tangible and useful out of it, and one of these things was coming up with that wish list, what is the minimum or desirable astroinformatics curriculum mm-hmm. at the graduate school level, which could well be in multiple layers. The basics, at the, you know, in some sense that every astronomer should understand what supervised unsupervised clustering is, in the same sense that they understand how spectrograph works without necessarily being able to make one, right? And then for people who really need to learn about a particular thing, that there is a means for them to go and learn it on their own terms, not taking a whole damn computer science class, but some accessible web-based material, could be videos, could be whatever, doesn't matter, that they can actually learn what they need to solve the research problem. Because I think something that comes all the time, students, graduate students, learn stuff because they need it for their research, not because it's in a class. I know I never learned damn thing in grad school in classes. I only learned stuff on my own because I really needed to know something. So there is a lot to be done. And, you know, please contribute your thoughts on this subject. You know, Facebook's the easiest way to do it. You can email us if you want. And, you know, we do want to distill this into a short document, which may hopefully spur more thinking about this. And I think Jan has certainly enough justification to call another workshop on this particular subject.
Yeah, with your input, I love it. So it's a pleasant surprise that Nicholas brought you over, and then great input. So wonderful.
So let me also suggest something I kind of mentioned previously, that another good tangible thing for us to try designing would be a platform for sharing of educational materials. It could be something as simple as links. Here is Kirk's useful class on this. Here is Brunner's useful class on that. Here is a really good article about neural nets. It, you know, start somewhere, mm-hmm. but start piling up a common resource from which students, teachers can try to construct the curricula that they actually need. I think that'll be a very practical and useful thing to start.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a platform?
Add to that, could we start by finding out which one, what common resources already exist,
yeah.
rather than by starting a new one?
Yes. There are incipient lists of that kind of stuff already. For example, International Virtual Observatory Alliance has a page mm-hmm. In Knowledge Discovery Data Mining Group that has some of that. That page is going to get a lot better within the next few months, I guarantee you. Because I think the new chair of that working group is going to kick ass. And, you know, there are forums
Eric Feigelson started what he calls Astroinformatics Portal. We'll see how well that works. But I always quote Benjamin Franklin's sentence that we should all hang together, or assuredly we will all hang separately. So, and that's all I have to say.
So, the organizer, the chair, the queen of the workshop.
I indeed, I got the lunch here for you. So, so this morning, let's recap. This morning, the bus didn't show up because the massive traffic jam for Microsoft company meeting once a year. Trust me, for the rest of the time of the year, we provide really nice transportations for the community so to reduce the traffic. So we got awarded by the state for that. Just once a year we do that. And then I learned that we messed up. We didn't order lunch. So and then George wanted an espresso, and our espresso bar is closed.
You call this a company?
And then Skype didn't work out as I expected, because on this podium machine, the Skype doesn't have the security setting is different from my machine. All these complications, but I'm glad we survived, and I'm truly grateful to everyone who's here today. So thank you all, and I hope we can continue talking in email. All right, enjoy the food that I worked so hard to bring it here.